start over. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Steve Edwards, the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics, and I'm so happy to have all of you here in this room with us today as we kick off the second year of the Sergeant Shriver Program for Leadership in Public Service. I've been at the Institute now for 3 years since we opened, and we do, as so many of you know, dozens upon dozens of programs in all of our different focus areas over the years. This program, without question, has been one of the most gratifying and inspiring programs that I've been a part of since I've been here at the Institute. It's steeped in the mission, which is to inspire and cultivate the next generation of public service leaders. It is rich with historical examples and methodology that will help you understand and acquire new tools to be effective, not only in your future careers, wherever they may lead you, but actually in your work and relationships right now. And the third part of this program that's so inspiring is it gives students an opportunity, actually, to build from these tools and historical examples to create something of real lasting value in the community today. We do these seminars over the course of the fall in 6 sessions, and then at the beginning of next year, there's an opportunity for about a dozen students to deepen their involvement and to work on a problem of real concern here in the Chicago area. Last year, we had an outstanding group of students do just that. I think they far surpassed my wildest expectations. I don't know about you, Jamie.
Yeah, mine too.
Jimmy McDonough is one of the students who was one of our Shriver Fellows from last year, and we're thrilled to have him here with
us. Here's another
I'm Matty Pisani here. I think just given the microphone situation, what I'll do is I'll have the two of you maybe speak at the end a little bit about your experience, if you don't mind. But I will say that these two are great testaments to Sergeant Shriver's legacy and to this program. So what is the program? Well, the program consists of these seminars. Now and over the 5 succeeding Fridays, we're going to spend 90 minutes with you in discussion, in workshops, exploring the creation of the Peace Corps. We're going to go deep into the origination of the concept from the 1960 presidential campaign of John F. Kennedy, when he first mentioned this idea in a speech on the steps of an auditorium in Ann Arbor, Michigan, at the University of Michigan, all the way to Sergeant Shriver's leadership of it and conceptualizing what this thing might be and look like in practice, to his ability to then institutionalize it within the framework of the United States government, White House, and Congress, and working through. So those of you that are actually trying to figure out how to make institutional change in the world, to work with other power players, this is a great lesson in that. All the way to how actually, once you've created this thing, do you actually build it and make it operational? How do you get volunteers? How do you publicize it? How do you train people? The Peace Corps represents a tremendous living example of how this work can result in transformative change, and I think has great application to the work that many of you are involved in currently on campus or off, and certainly will be a touchstone for work that you may do in the future. So, without further ado, let me stop and introduce the person who I think has been more central to this entire enterprise than anybody else. He'll be with us throughout this journey. He is the executive director of the Sergeant Shriver Peace Institute. He has become more than a collaborator, just a dear, dear friend, and somebody who has taught me a tremendous amount, just as he's taught so many of the students who went through our program last year. Please join me in welcoming Jamie Price. Jamie.
Oh, I'm already here. Thank you very much. It's really exciting to see all of you here. I'll tell you a little bit about me and about the Peace Institute and this partnership, and then introduce the main show today, which is Kirby Jones. I'm an alum here. I want you to know that I got my PhD at the Divinity School, so that's part of my connection. It's been an extraordinary time over the last year building a partnership between the IOP and the Sergeant Shriver Peace Institute. The Peace Institute was created to help let people know what Sergeant Shriver did, what his methods were in doing it, and helping people to do likewise. And the significance of those methods, as you'll find out from today and going forward, is that it helped people what Sarge said late in his life, break their mirrors in ways that enabled them to connect with communities and build them in positive peacemaking ways. He has an extraordinary legacy. He started his life here in Chicago, and we'll talk about this this next week. But he helped to desegregate. He was very pronounced in civil rights. He helped to desegregate the Catholic high schools, and he was president of the Board of Education here. He started the Peace Corps, ran the war on poverty, was involved in nuclear arms control, set up the first interreligious trialogue for the Middle East, did all kinds of amazing things. And the thing that was extraordinary about him was not what he did specifically, but the kind of method that he used, the sort of approach that he brought to this. And it's a counterpart to the one we normally experience, which is kind of a Hobbesian war of all against all. You need power to make anything happen. His was grounded in something else. And what we're going to talk about today, Revolutionary Fire, Making Peace in the Midst of War, is kind of a proof text of what Sarge's method was. We wanted to start you off on the journey of this case study with an example of, I mean, a high-profile example of what he did and what the program, what the Peace Corps did to make peace. And we want to start that as the intro to engage you in curiosity about, my goodness, how do you do that? How can you be somebody who can think about creating a program that will position people to make peace in this very dangerous and radical world? So that's where we want to start. And the person who can talk about that most authoritatively is to my right, Kirby Jones, Peace Corps volunteer, who was in the Dominican Republic when in April of 1965, war broke out. And it's kind of a test case for the Peace Corps that it actually makes peace and does so. But Kirby is an extraordinary friend who is a living text in himself as to how this worked and how this happened and how he did it 50 years ago.
All right, so join us in welcoming Kirby Jones. It's great to have you back here. And I should say that of the sessions we did last year, we heard from a number of students that their favorite was the one that you participated in. So we thought, why save the best for last? Let's lead with in my former tradition of profession of journalism, broadcast journalism, they always said, lead with your best tape. So we're leading with our best tape today. And what we're gonna do is immerse you into 1965, as we mentioned, but a little bit of context. What was happening in the world in the early 1960s? What was going on? Cold War? What happened just a couple of years before then that was a flashpoint of the Cold War? Cuban Missile Crisis, right? We had the Bay of Pigs. The hottest point, arguably, in the Cold War is happening just miles, really, from the Dominican Republic, where Kirby Jones, how old were you when you were in the Peace Corps?
22. 22.
All right, 22. What prompted you to join the Peace Corps in the first place?
Well, I drank the Kennedy Kool-Aid. I mean, here was a young president, and he asked me to do something. He asked all of us to do something, and people like to be asked. And he said, join me, ask not what your country can do for you, etc. New frontier. I raised my hand, along with lots of other people, and signed up to save the world, Kennedy style.
Yes. So you join the Peace Corps, you go through training, and we'll talk in later sessions about what that process entails, right, and what's about. But you are ultimately sent to the Dominican Republic in December of 1963. As you arrive in the Dominican Republic, what were your first impressions? What was going through your mind at that moment in time?
We arrived in December 63 in a program called Urban Community Development. It was the first urban program in the DR. They had a few in Peru and a few other places, but it was thought to be oh, volunteers can't work in the cities, that's too dangerous, that's too this, that's too that. But Sarge et al. Decided to send these guys down there and see what they can do. We went to the training. Once you put up the map, we went, and I'll come to the map in a second. We went through training, and we went down to work in the urban slums of Santo Domingo. And there you have a map. And if you head north where it says Las Cañitas, you'll see a great white, and to the left, you'll see vast white spaces.
Straight up at the top of the screen here, if you come just to the left of the key, is
right,
Las Cañitas.
It's way at the top. And hundreds of thousands of people lived where you see white space. And the government that created this map created a map which indicated nobody lived there, which in a sense is what the government thought. Living there was the most highly dense populated area of the city, and that's where we went. And the job was, how do you, here I was, a 22-year-old young kid who was a poli-sci major, didn't know how to do anything, in my Peace Corps uniform, had my jeans and my t-shirt and the sneakers on, jauntily walking into the slum barrio, barely speaking the language, and supposed to do something. What was I supposed to do? Something.
They didn't tell you what to do.
They didn't tell what to do. And it's not like being a well driller or a forestry or nurses or some of the other volunteers that the Peace Corps sent. They had a job. They had an identity. I'm a well driller. I'm an agricultural person, co-ops. I'm a nurse. I'm a poli-sci major? I mean, it's not going to make... But the theory of community development, I don't want to get too far ahead here because we're going to touch that, is if you take a relatively homogeneous community and drop in there something new and totally different, and boy, was I different. A white American in this universally black area who didn't speak Spanish, I was as different as you could possibly get. If you drop that difference in and that person starts, stuff happens. You upset the calmness, the regularity, and you, by just being there, the theory goes, make stuff happen. And what is interesting is that the theory and the make stuff happen, the theory was correct. So I'm working up there, and it took me about 5 months to learn the language. I said yes a lot when I couldn't understand it. Dominicans speak very sloppy language. But I woke up one day realizing that I had understood everything the day before, which was sort of like a liberation for me. And I could then go out and really start engaging the people and finding out what to do.
And how did you know what to do? How did you even approach that? Where to be useful?
I started by walking into store, sort of like a 7-Eleven, right at the entrance of the barrio. And I started to explain John Kennedy and Sergeant Shriver and the Peace Corps, and the eyes just... I tried that for about a week, 2 weeks. It didn't work.
Nobody cared.
I couldn't say it very well. And two, nobody cared, even if I could have. But we were unusual. So what happens? You attract the young kids who are running along. Who are these Americans? They had nothing else to do. They weren't in school. They weren't wearing shoes. Half of them were naked, running through the streets. And we were the event of the day. And gradually, one thing led to another, and more kids came, and we picked up some baseballs and bats from the Peace Corps office, and we said to these kids, let's go out and play baseball. So we took out these 9 and 10-year-olds and started playing baseball. Well, a few weeks later, their 14, 15-year-old brothers came by and said, we'd like to have a baseball team. Okay, so we got another baseball team. Then the 18, 19-year-old brothers came, and they wanted to have a baseball team. So we then had an identity. We were these Americans here teaching baseball. By that time, we had moved into the barrio, and there were some pictures there of the house. Keep going back a little bit. That's a good one to start with. That's outside my house. The dwellings in the barrio, the living in the barrio, if you take your house, or your parents' house, where you live, and you take out the landscaping, you take out the sidewalks, you move the house right up to the street, you take all the paving off the street, you're left with dirt. When it rains, it's muddy, and when it's dry, it's really dusty. Then you go to your house, take off the second floor, because there is no second floors. You don't see any second floors there. You walk into the lower level. You can keep the living room, but shrink it down about a quarter of the size. Take out the furniture. Put in one seat and one sofa with a plastic covering. Take out all the lights, all the plugs, because you don't have any electricity. Go in the kitchen. Take out the refrigerator. Take out the dishwasher. Take out the microwave. Take out the stove. Take out the sink, because you have no water. So you don't need a sink if you have no water. And by the way, take out all the bathrooms, because there's no plumbing, and you use a latrine in the back. That's where you start. And that's was our house. And we had one light bulb, which came on every now and then, no water, and you saw in the kitchen, if you no stove, you had a little charcoal burner right there in the gas burner, one table, a few pots, and the next slide you show our, that's where you kept your water in that thing there. Every day you filled up that water. And then the next slide shows the beautiful bedroom with a screen to keep away the flying cockroaches. So we had an identity. We were the Peace Corps. And we moved into the house, and then we had these baseball teams. And through the kids, what happens? You meet the parents. So finally, we were beginning to get into the community. They accepted what we were doing. They accepted our role. And we began to force the issue. You've got these baseball teams, you know, with three or four or five of them. What else do you want to do? And they said, we want to put names on the streets and numbers on the houses. I'd never thought of that, right? And why? So we can receive mail. And you think about it, you can't get mail unless you have an address. These people were in that white area. They had no address. They didn't exist. Their friends and families couldn't find them. They had no phones. There were two phones in the entire barrio, both managed by police types. So we went to the mayor's office. Who puts in the phones? I mean, who puts in the street names? The city should do that. And the numbers in the houses. So the city has to do that. We went to the mayor. They had never been to the mayor. So the mayor, why do they see us? Because I'm there. We're there. These white Americans are there. Oh my God! I better see these guys. And behind us come the representatives of the barrio, and we get in the door. They come in. We fade back, and they do the talking. And the mayor said, agreed to the names, agreed to the numbers. They came out, and you Google Earth, Barrio Simón Bolívar, and up will pop all the streets with all the names, including Calle Cuerpo de Paz, which is Peace Corps Street, which is out there too. So then the next thing is, what next do you want to do? We want to rename our barrio. It was named El Aljibe, which means the well. Why? That was the name that the dictator Trujillo put on their barrio. They wanted their own name. So they picked, what name do you want? And it was, we want Simón Bolívar. Okay, back to the mayor. Who names places? The city does. Back to the mayor. He knew us now, right? He knew these people and came in and they asked for the name, Shave. Quite frankly, I don't think the mayor gave a hoot what the name was. He said yes, signed, sealed, and delivered. And they put up, there is still today, there's a sign there that says Barrio Simón Bolívar. You go to Google Earth again and it's Barrio Simón Bolívar. So it's there. So that's how, there's more to that story, but yeah. You want to
Well, I want to pause on this for a moment and bring Jamie in because there are two things that I think are interesting. One, in both of the examples where you go to the mayor's office, you said in passing that you stood aside and then let the residents go through. I mean, why didn't you just sort of go to the mayor's office? Was that something that you intuitively knew? Was that part of your training? What's going on there that leads you to think that there's a different kind of collaborative dynamic in your relationship early on?
Because the goal was to get them to understand the process. The goal was not what you did, but how you did it. And to take people to whom there was no hope or expectation of really much of anything to realize, holy cow, we can do something. Yeah. So part of that is, we'll get you in the door because we're Peace Corps volunteers. But once we're in the door, and we explain this and sort of rehearse it, you guys take over, and they stepped up to the plate and really weren't shy about it.
So, Jamie, what's going on here from Sergeant Shriver's perspective in terms of how he's thinking about change in the world and the examples that Kirby has just relayed?
Well, I mean, Kirby said, here I am, just a poli-sci major. I hardly speak the language, and I get dropped off in a place with no name to speak of. And so how in the world? There was a method to Sarge's madness in doing that. There definitely was.
His idea wasn't just to put a 22-year-old in Santo Domingo to play baseball.
Parachute? No. What his idea was that the Dominican Republic would request Peace Corps volunteers to help in various ways that they wanted to. Sarge's goal throughout this whole thing was to build peace between Americans and people living in the developing world. And his notion of how to do that was through people-to-people contact, and he knew that conflict behavior is really a matter of feeling threatened and to deciding to defend what feels threatened. And so his idea was the way to build peace is to eliminate threat. And the way you eliminate threat, particularly the threat of a gringo coming in, you know, with all the, it wasn't as though people in the Dominican Republic trusted the U.S. or trusted Americans. So you had to set up the conditions in which that would happen, and you do that by doing what Kirby did. I mean, having a framework in which Kirby goes in there and says, what do you need? What do you want?
Here's what I think we should do.
Here's what I think we should do. I know what your problem is. Let me solve it for you.
Which is what Americans do all the time.
All the time. All the time. And it's what we all tend to do because, I mean, there's this locus of control that we think we have. We have something to give, and we want to give it, and forget that a person needs to ask. A person needs to be open. A person needs to want it. And you know, the Peace Corps position Kirby and everybody like him who went to the Dominican Republic and all 220,000 Peace Corps volunteers to this day to learn the language of the people, to anchor themselves in the customs. I mean,
to live in the community.
Kirby was living right there. I mean, he wasn't living in the embassy compound. He wasn't living in the Hotel Embajador. He was there with everybody else. And so whatever projections they had, whatever threats they had, would be sort of like, well, who is this guy?
And why the hell is he living out here?
Right. So it opens up curiosity. And the problem with conflict is that we're really righteous, we're really certain, and we're sure we know who the other person is, and we're sure we know what we need to do to take care of it. And when Kirby said the theory was you come in and you make a change and something happens, the change that he made was opening up curiosity, including the curiosity to say, what do you need? And who would have thought address, who would have thought street names and barrio names and stuff?
Yeah, did you have any idea that's what you would be working
zero.
On?
Zero. And Sarge knew enough to think, well, how can we know what the solutions to the problems are before we even know what the problems are? So we set this thing up to discover those. And that's what they did. Yeah.
Let me stop here for a second. And for those of you who just come in, grab seats, feel free to sit in. What questions do you have right now about any of the experiences that Kirby is relaying? Any questions or thoughts? Yeah.
This may sound kind of cynical, but sort of since it was the Cold War era, did they make you guys kind of show to all the people there that you were Americans, kind of because you wanted to have like an American presence there? Maybe because I think maybe the government might have been worried that these Latin American countries might fall to the communism.
People may have worried about that, but we said we were Americans because that's what we are, right? We are what we are. Did we flaunt it or make a case that we're other than we're just ordinary Americans? No, but we didn't shy away from it. But what he said is right, that this anti-American feeling came, United States, not only the Bay of Pigs and the Missile Crisis, we had supported dictators, the Somozas, the Trujillos, the Batistas, Jimenez in Venezuela. We had a very long record of being on the other side. So there was a built-in existing, the United States doesn't always do good things.
And your question gets at the heart of tensions that we'll be exploring later in future sessions, which is essentially, how do you create, as part of this society and this government, a program that is genuinely responsive to the human needs of people from different cultures, and that is not, while it may be in service of U.S. broader interests, it is not a tool of U.S. foreign policy and is not beholden to U.S. foreign policy and security interests in quite the same way. Yeah,
Blake. Were there things that you and your cohort tried to implement that were not successful while you were there?
Well, the things that you and your cohort tried to implement that were not successful.
This organization wanted to formalize themselves into a club or a community organization, and they wanted to have elections, or they wanted to name. They wanted to have a president, vice president, officers of this organization. And we said, I remember talking to Joe, my partner, hey, this is great, we're gonna have an election. And there, so we said, okay, let's have an election. Well, you have nominations, you have seconds, and you have this and that. No. Why are we doing all this nomination election? We know who the leaders are, Pedro and so we all agreed they're going to be the leaders, and we fought that and lost and realized we don't want to fight this fight today. So their concept of leaders and how you get leaders was very different than the traditional American democracy kind of thing. And later on there were certain projects that failed and then succeeded. Some didn't go so well, and some. But failure's okay. I mean, it was not. It didn't cost anybody anything.
Yeah. Well, speaking of leaders, it's a nice transition into. Maddie, please, yes, and I'll come back to that transition. Yes.
My question was just: were you lonely when you got there? What was it like?
Were you lonely when you got there?
Well, I was working with another guy, right? That they didn't want to send volunteers alone into these dangerous urban slums. They would send volunteers alone into rural communities, a zillion miles from everywhere, but not into the urban areas. But remember, this is the era long before no cell phones, no computer, no email, no telephones. Letter writing was your means of communication. So to the extent that you could not go back to the United States for 2 years, for any reason, death in the family, zero reason. You go back, you have to resign. So whether you're in the slums of San Domingo or in Vanuatu, where other volunteers were in the middle of the Pacific, it was a gazillion miles away. And I do write later on of feeling lonely, and I ask myself, how can you feel lonely surrounded by thousands of people? But you get lonely for what is comfortable at home, you know. Sort of
and, we should point out, for those of you that have an interest in the Peace Corps or may have served more recently, that not only has the technology changed, but their restrictions on travel to and from the placement
it's very different now,
destination
yeah. Yeah.
have relaxed considerably since then. Yeah, Chris.
So you talked briefly about the coming, being exposed to this new space, this urban area, being one of the only or few white males. Right. Within that space. Can you kind of talk more about how that experience influenced your thoughts around race or your feelings around race and class being in that situation?
Specifically, I don't think it did, one way or the other. It was just what it was. I mean, the DR is a very mixed, as is Cuba, as is several other countries, very from the white Spanish to the African black. And most are in between. So in the case of the DR, most were in between. There was an upper class, old Spanish class, lived downtown, which was white, which is also typical of Cuba and a lot of other countries. So did I think about it a lot? No, it wasn't a factor, really, to be honest with you.
Other questions here? I want to, yeah, Jimmy.
Maybe I'm curious about getting back to the way the impact that you had on taking the, helping the villagers in Simón Bolívar take the initiative on changing the names of the streets. What exactly was that, was your impact, and what did the Peace Corps bring to those people, those slum dwellers that they didn't have before?
Sociologists have analyze kids' drawings done in barrios, particularly Oscar Lewis in Puerto Rico, which he talks about the culture of poverty. And kids, when they draw stick figures, draw them, many of them, without hands or feet, which the shrinks say that is the demonstration of powerlessness. So in the back of our minds is, how do you take people who realize they have been forgotten, whose daily lives are survival each day? You have no refrigerator, so you buy the food you eat that day and consume it. You don't store it, and you do the same thing next day. And they have no experience bettering how they live. Here we come. We upset the apple cart a bit because all these kids are running around and they're going home talking to their parents, and these white Americans are here, and that's different. And our job was not to decide what you do. Don't you want Americans like schools and they like this and they like that. Don't you want A, B, or C? No. They could have said, we want a swimming pool. Right? That's fine with me. Because...
And that was part of the training?
Part of the training. It's the act of achieving something. Now, how do you go about getting a swimming pool? I have no idea, right? But I'd find out and help them through that process. That did eventually happen, which we'll get to a little bit later. But yeah. It wasn't all baseball teams and names. We got involved in some much bigger projects. The club got involved in much bigger projects, which we kept pushing along. We'd make a phone call here or talk to somebody there or come up with this idea. But the major push always came from the local people.
And at the core of this is this idea of service, but the animating force on both sides, as you said before, is curiosity. Curiosity of the residents to the newcomers, curiosity of the newcomers to the needs and lives of the residents, right? All right, Tyler.
what was the process like of asking people, what do you need or what do you want? How do you go about that?
We didn't ask that question. We tried to come up with way, and we talked about it. There would be a meeting of the club, right? Which would be, you know, 10 or 15 people, of which one, two, or three were the president and that sort of thing. And they'd meet in our house. And we had a big open room. And it was more, what do you want to do? The next thing was pay those streets. What they wanted done, which the city, the mayor, our wonderful mayor.
And why did you ask it that way? Why was it, what do you want to do as opposed to what do you need or what do you want?
Because, well, I mean,
you know what I'm saying? I mean, that's a distinctive difference.
Come back to the swimming pool. The swimming pool is not a need. Once you say what do you need, you're limiting the question because the swimming pool is not a, you don't need a swimming pool. Right? So you open up as wide as possible because you don't, we didn't care what they needed or what they wanted. It was, this was another process to doing something. And I found
together.
Out. Together. And I found out 50 years later that they, which we'll talk about at the end, they took that process and indeed did apply it to other things.
And the other thing about asking, what do you want to do is, it's asking what are you willing to decide about? What are you willing to put into action? What are you willing to, as opposed to what do you need is important, but it's about, it's a different place in the action process. And I think you need to go from where people are willing to move.
Yeah, I mean, what do you need?
I haven't had a job in 6 months. I need a job. Can you, Mr. Peacekeeper, get me a job?
Right. It implies what can someone else do for me versus what do you want to do suggests what can we participate in or what are you willing to invest in?
What they want to do.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So, I mean, I think it's fascinating because I think that this applies clearly in the context of your lived experience as a Peace Corps volunteer. But I think as all of you can relate, it is something that can be applied in our day-to-day relationships as we encounter people from backgrounds different from our own. It also can be played out very demonstrably as we here on the south side of Chicago, as we here as Americans are engaging with people from different community and cultural contexts in any kind of service work that we do. Thinking about it a different way is a fundamental shift than the way we may be acculturated to think here in the United States. Let me pause on this. We'll come back and have opportunities for you to contribute further to the conversation, but I want to move us further in the chronology. I mentioned politics in passing, and just for the briefest of backgrounds, Kirby mentioned Trujillo, who was a dictator in power for about 30 years in the Dominican Republic. In the early 1960s, he was thrown out of power. There was a democratically elected leader who was then the victim of a military coup. There was a triumvirate in power then for about a year and a half or so thereafter, kept promising a return to elections. But that wasn't forthcoming. And so take us to this. So this is all backdrop within the political environment of the Dominican Republic. Kirby, take us to April 24th, 1965.
Put the map back up if you would. April 24th, a lot has happened in the barrio between where we left off with the paved road.
You've been there a year and a half, by the way.
I've been there a year and a half, and a lot has happened, and we'll come back to that. So April 24th was a Saturday. It hadn't rained in weeks, and when it doesn't rain, the water pressure goes down. And when the water pressure goes down, when you have one spigot to serve a barrio at the, and people, women, all women, lined up with these cans, that water pressure coming out is a trick, not a trickle, but is really slow. It's a super pain in the neck to get your water, which you have to do every day. So people were tense in general. In the meantime, things were going on that we didn't know anything about, which were unrest in the army and some military officers. They didn't like this guy, Donald Ray Cabral. And they, April 24th, I had a secondary job. I had a job at Radio San Domingo, which is number, let me walk over here. I think it looks like it should be number 10.
Number seven, it looks like.
Number seven. Fine, where is number seven?
Right, just to the right of there.
Okay, there it is, okay. I had a job there, helping to produce a public health television program. I had worked at a TV station in college. I'm gonna stand for a minute. So I had a weekly program on public health. So I went to my Saturday weekly program, and I'm going in the door, and Manolo Quiroz, who is the director of the program, met me at the door and said, "Kirby, there's no program today." And I said, "No program, why?" "Oh, well, the equipment is all broken, the signal is very bad today, or the Fritz is out of frats," and so stuff I didn't, he just said, "There is no program today," was clear. "I will take you to get your bus." I had to take two sort of buses to get the seven. From Las Canitas to number seven was two bus rides. So he took me, and I went home. That night, revolution started. And his job, he was the inside man at Radio San Domingo, which was the TV station. And what do rebels do everywhere? They go after the guns and the means of communication. And they did that. They went after the guns and got them. And they went after the radio TV station and got that. And Manolo Quiroz's job was keep that American out of here this Saturday, because he was the inside man. So I go back to Las Canitas, and my partner is downtown. Look at 17. Is that 18?
17 is Independence Park.
Yeah, but anyway, the Peace Corps office is down there. It's in that part of the city. The rebels took over, attacked the police station, captured all the guns, and there were a lot of them, distributed the guns. The rebels were all over the TV station and the police station, and their troops were all through the northern part of the city. Guys who were on my baseball team, who played right field one day, were walking around the barrio with a M16 the next day. So their day had come. Camaño, the leader, was down 9-13. It's part of the old town. Headquarters were down there. The troops were up there. They were captured the radio station. They captured the guns. They captured the presidential palace. Donald Reed Cabral went in a tunnel out to the U.S. Embassy, and the rebels were roaming around this very quickly, took 3 or 4 days, but roaming around the upper part of the city. You see number six there, Duarte Bridge. I, from Las Canitas, I could see the planes dive bombing Duarte Bridge, because on this side of the city, on the right across that bridge, was Weston E. Wesson, who had an Air Force base next to the commercial airfield. He had the airplanes, he had the tanks. That bridge was the only link.
He was not part of the rebel.
He was not part of the rebel force. That's the only bridge. That bridge goes, you don't go from that side to that side. So who controlled the bridge controlled the traffic in and out of the city. So there was a calls on the radio, go to the bridge, go to the bridge, go to the bridge. And you can see the planes. I mean, the planes were dived by, and you could hear them, and you could hear the guns and the machine guns. It was the real deal.
Yeah. I wonder if we should play the clip of you reflecting on your experiences in the hospital. Would you mind setting up your experiences
there? The Peace Corps, none of us knew what to do with us. Stay or go. On the 28th, 4 days later, the Marines landed, ostensibly to protect American lives. People were evacuated, families, children, wives. Peace Corps volunteers, several were evacuated in that first group, some, not many. And so there were some troops there. And on the 29th and 30th, Johnson sent more troops in, convinced that this was a communist revolution. And the volunteers, we had two phones, you know, and we were debating the other day how I communicated with the Peace Corps. I'm not sure how I did, because they couldn't call me. I must have gone to somebody's house and asked to use their phone. But we were told, I felt very safe where I was. I wasn't as safe as I thought, but I felt safe.
You felt safe at the barrio?
Because I was surrounded by friends. Everybody knew me. So I felt, I'm about to say fine, but I wasn't fine, but I felt fine. Then the peace, in the last talk with the Peace Corps is, you got to get out of there. We hear there's going to be a lot of fighting across the north. It's safe to go to the hospitals. And the hospital is the back to the map, if you would. The hospital is number, oh, here we go. It has no number. It's where it says La Caridad. Go left a little bit where it says Avenida de los Martires. It's sort of right in there.
So
it's about a mile and a half away. They said, go to the hospital, without exactly saying, how do you get to the hospital? Because walking in the streets was not the best thing to do then. So Kay, we'll see a picture later. It was a female volunteer, and I were the only ones left out there. There she is on the right. We came up with the brilliant idea of, well, we're going to disguise ourselves as doctors. How we were going to do that, I'm not really sure. But we took a Peace Corps medical kit and cut out tape and put red tape across and found some sort of smocks or something. Because there was a medical dispensary around, we got some smocks and put a mask around. So, you know, it sort of looked like a doctor, and off we go, walking down the street, trying to get to this hospital through who knows what. We finally found a car who was going in that direction. We said, will you give us a ride? We're doctors, we're going to the hospital.
And is this amidst gunfire, amidst skirmishes?
Bodies on the street. There was a lot of shooting. And it wasn't that, I didn't think they were gonna come after me, but you didn't wanna be in a situation where there was shooting, because there's shooting, so it's not a good place to be. So I get to this hospital. And I'll set up a tape. In this hospital, already 5 Peace Corps nurses. In this hospital, there's no electricity because it's out all over the city. There's no water. So a hospital without electricity, without water, in a war zone, is not a recipe for niceness. There's no x-ray machine, so you couldn't, from a practical level, the doctors could not find the bullets in the bodies, other than looking inside the bodies for bullets. So I arrived, Kay arrived, and there were about...
Sorry, it automatically hit on its own, sorry.
And there were about 4 of us who weren't nurses there, 4 or 5 of us, and there were 5 Peace Corps nurses who were really running that hospital at that time.
All right. Now let's see if I can get this going. And this is Kirby in his own voice reflecting on that experience.
50 years ago. Yeah.
Like a month later.
Hold on a second.
It was a month later.
No, yeah. I don't know where my, there we go. Can't find my cursor.
It was sort of similar when I first started. I too thought it was just sort of an interesting game type of deal. The fighting was quite a distance from where I was. Nobody in the body had been killed. Everything was sort of far away. You could look up in the sky and see the plane dive by. You know, it was sort of like watching movies at Tokyo all over again. It wasn't actually until I got to the hospital that I really realized what was going on. And I saw a fantastic number of wounded being brought in, and really gruesome, bad wounds. That really affected me. First day was I'd never been in a hospital, never seen any amount of people wounded, much less their whole bodies just ripped apart. And we began bringing these 12-year-old kids with their heads blown open, and women and 17-year-old boys with their whole bodies sort of riddled with bullets. I felt that regardless of the political implications or anything, as long as they stopped the fighting. And it really got to me, just seeing people, just cut down. It was quite upset in the hospital. And then finally, the last one was there. I had helped on two operations with these young kids, and both of them died. And then I was also had to go outside to fix a generator. And they were shooting outside, and I was just petrified going outside. And so I finally called the office and told them to get me out. And I did. I left the next day. But and even after that, I remember when I was downtown hearing the shooting. All I could see.
Sorry, this is too sensitive, guys. I just left us. Hold on one second. Sorry, my apologies. Hold on. Let's go right back to you.
I had to go outside to fix a generator. And they were shooting outside, and I was just petrified going outside. And so I finally called the office and told them to get me out. And I did. I left the next day. But and even after that, I remember when I was downtown hearing the shooting. All I could see was every shot is somebody else. There, somebody else would be lying on the street. And I think that has really been my pervading preoccupations of the entire thing. That the political implications and everything are very important. When you see people that are just cut down, to me, it just supersedes everything.
It's powerful to hear you recall that 50 years before. When we were talking upstairs, you also relayed an incident that I don't know if it preceded or followed this, where somebody you knew well from the barrio grabbed his gun and came by your house where you were living and said, "Are you with me? Are we going out tonight?" What happened?
Well, a guy who I knew came by. He was going down to the bridge to fight, and he said, basically, I don't remember the exact words, but it was, "Look, we've been working. You've lived with us now for a year and a half, and are you with us or against us? It's sort of on your. Are you on our side or their?" He didn't say you're on our side or their side. Are you with us?
Can I stop you before you give your answer? So, what would you do in that situation?
Good question.
You've lived and worked with these people. You've seen the impact of the fighting. Are you with us or against us?
It's a tough one, isn't it?
How many people here think they might be with them? Understandable. How many people think you might be against them? How many against?
It's not against, it's not with.
Then there's the third. I was going to go there.
Okay.
Then there's a third of not against, but not with. How many people would be in that space? Okay. For those of you who said you'd be not against, but not with, why? Maddie?
It reminds me a little bit of what you talked about last year, how the Americans had come in from the Marines, I think, and they were sort of there to protect American interests and to protect the democratically elected person. I don't remember exactly. And so I feel like what you said, because you were the Peace Corps, because you knew them, or you knew the people you'd been working with so well, they didn't consider you like those Americans, they considered you their friends kind of thing. And so like from that perspective, I see an ability to sort of not be with the Americans in the sense that you're against the people you're friends with, but also not necessarily having to be on the side of the people.
Yeah,
Blaine. Even going off of that, I think that because of that relationship of still being American, but also having that tie to the people after having been there for so long, I think that that gives, like, as a unique position where I could see where someone would obviously not go right to war and, like, grab a gun and try to fight, but maybe, like, talk with the American officers, like, plead with them to not, like, shoot and kill. All these people that you've been working with for all this time, because like it would, in the end, like destroy all the work that you've done for this long. So I don't know, I see it as it's a hard situation, but I see it almost as by being in the middle of it, you almost have a little bit more power with that decision that you make.
For somebody here who said they would say they'd be with the friend, why? What's the rationale there? Anyone? I mean, this isn't an easy question, so there's no right or wrong answer yet.
Through over the years, Pat, you know these people, and I think maybe you've come to understand what the rationales are, why they want to fight, why they do not want to live under the rule that they have elected, although democratically elected. And maybe you can get beyond the ideology and beyond like this Cold War rhetoric and just like simply empathize with them.
Yeah. So what did you do, Kirby?
I answered them saying, I cannot help some Dominicans kill other Dominicans. And he went on his way. And what happened is after the hospital, and we made a decision to get involved in food distribution, there was no food coming into the barrios, and so we essentially stole some, liberated some food from the USAID offices and CARE, and loaded them into Peace Corps trucks. And Camaño, who was downtown, announced that the only Americans allowed in his area of the city were Peace Corps volunteers. He had heard about our work at the hospitals, heard about the food, and so that we put.
This is the commander of the rebel forces.
Remember that city where the commander is way in the south, the rebels are way in the north. The U.S. had see that block line going from Duarte Bridge all the way down. They had cut off the head from the body. And so there were checkpoints, there were U.S. checkpoints, Dominican military checkpoints, rebel checkpoints. So you go from either way, north to south, you go through six checkpoints into the corridor and then out of the corridor. And we put Cuerpo de Paz in the trucks, all over the trucks, and we could drive back and forth, and did. Took food out to the barrios, and because the Maya Bridge way in the top, that's the link to the northern part of the country where all the produce comes in. That was totally cut off, so no food was getting in. So you had a situation, it was not a good situation.
You also have this other question that you alluded to, which is, should the Peace Corps volunteers, along with all of the other Americans in the Dominican Republic, leave the country in light of the escalating security situation, the fighting, the sense that you could be not only just caught in the crossfire, you could actually be targeted by virtue of, you know, your nationality. Jamie, help flesh out what was going on in Washington at the time as there was this debate over whether they should evacuate or not Peace Corps volunteers in particular.
Well, there were two debates going on. One was the debate by the Johnson administration, and that debate had to do with, just quickly to set some of the context of this, Camaño and the rebels that, or the constitutionalists as they called themselves, that Kirby was talking about, had pretty much won the day, but the assumption was that they were communists, and so there was a cable that was sent by the American ambassador saying, There's been a request by the head of the police force, who was supposed to be riot control and stabilized, that they can't protect American lives, which led Johnson to send in 30,000 troops and cut everything off. So there was, their decision was, we need to go in to protect American lives, to stabilize them. For Shriver and the Peace Corps staff, there had been other experiences in Panama earlier, where there were riots in the Panama Canal. And it had turned out that, and one of the reasons Shriver fought for the independence of the Peace Corps was so that he could make decisions like this by himself rather than have the Secretary of State do it, to decide how the program would operate. And they were in touch by cable every 4 or 5 hours, monitoring the situation, and decided that the Peace Corps volunteers were safer in the community, with the community, that they had made friends, they had made peace, and that it was better that they stay where they were. Although the Peace Corps volunteers were given the option to go if they needed to, and as Kirby said, a couple did, but there were 109 in the country at the time, and well over 100 decided to stay. And
I mean, it's a one thing to stay and fight. It's another thing to stay and not fight.
Well, right.
So where does that thinking come from? What's going on there?
Well, I think it has a lot to do with, I mean, what Kirby just illustrated, the role. I mean, if you stay and fight, you're a soldier, presumably, and you understand what your responsibilities are, and they're to pick up a gun, and they're to carry out that task. Kirby's task, and the task of the other Peace Corps volunteers, they too were employees of the federal government. They were representatives of the United States, and their task was to be with the people that they'd come to serve, to help them, to meet their needs, and that was their charge. I mean, not only in terms of their felt sense of themselves, but their reality. And Kirby made very strategic decisions about what was safe and what wasn't safe, and all the Peace Corps volunteers did. They ran the hospital while the Dominican nurses left. I mean, there's a way in which the roles and responsibilities we have kind of shape what we think is plausible and right to do and set the framework for that. And so for Kirby, I don't mean to speak for you, although I will, there was a sense that it was my responsibility, my job. I came here to do this. I came here with these ideals to make friends and build peace for the United States and for the Peace Corps and for these folks, and so I need to stay if I possibly can.
Kirby, what do you say about that? What was it that compelled you and the other volunteers to stay at that point? I mean, you'd been there long enough. You could have easily said, hey, I've done 18 months of great work here. I can go home with my head held high.
I didn't think. To me, there almost was. I didn't think about having to make a decision. There was no decision. I was staying and going back. Period. I mean, the alternative just was not thinkable.
Think about that, though. Think about an alternative, like not to leave.
Think about if you're in Syria right now, you know?
Yeah, right. Not to leave a violent situation in which, what Kirby's also said, a situation in which it felt to him like his country had invaded his country. And bullets are...
We were pissed off, too. As volunteers, we were pissed off at the U.S. government. It was a combination of one, with Kamanya's announcement and our going back and forth and the expressions that came at the Peace Corps, you were damn proud to be a member of that organization. Really proud. And in the back of your mind, thank you, Sergeant Shriver, for creating this environment in which I have the privilege of living, right? On one hand. On the other hand, we made some food runs. But we came back and we got caught really caught right in between a machine gun crossfire. And it was not pretty. It was not nice. So you didn't want to get shot either. And third, we were pissed off. by the end, I mean, I'm really mad. And we wrote a letter to Johnson, signed by 32 volunteers, saying politely, your policy stinks and here's why, and there were about 10 points that we gave. And in our arrogant 22-year-old way, we said, you have 24 hours to get back to us. Or we're gonna hold a press conference. The letter was, Shriver was out of town. The letter, so he was in New Hampshire. The letter goes to the head of Latin America, Frank Mankiewicz. He gets his letter. And he picks up the phone and calls Bill Moyers, who was the original number two in the Peace Corps, then Johnson's press secretary, and says, Bill, you're going to get a letter. He says, I have the letter. He says, you better get over here. So Mankiewicz, obviously he told me this later, goes over to the White House, and Moyers says, he says, I can't physically hand this letter to the president. He is so pissed off at those volunteers for being against his policy, that if he actually reads this letter, he's gonna pull them all out. So you better get down there and shut them up. Mankiewicz came down.
It comes down to the Dominican Republic.
We were in Puerto Rico,
Puerto Rico.
At the termination conference. Okay. He comes down to Puerto Rico, and he was coming down to address us about that letter. And he does. He comes in and he's very clever. He comes in and says, I'm here to tell you that the President of the United States is now fully aware of everything you said in your letter. Well, we heard, oh, the President's seen our letter. Frank didn't say that. But he was also true in that the President knew what we felt about what was happening, which is what we said in the letter. And Mankiewicz then explained that if we hold a press conference, you got to think of what it's going to do to you and the Peace Corps and the Peace Corps in other countries, blah, 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 blah. And he said, you guys make the decision. And he walked out of the room and left us to decide and debate. And there were three or four people who signed the letter, Skip Andrew, one of the authors of the letter, being one, who wanted to hold a press conference. Others of us didn't, because we didn't want to leave. We were convinced that if we did, we were going to leave. And so we didn't help. We didn't, yeah, never held a press conference and stayed. And then the option was, do you want to stay through your original termination the end of August, or do you want to go June 1st? And Skip and Hazel left on June 1st. Steve Elwick had already gone. There were a bunch of people, some who left then for a variety of reasons. And the majority stayed.
Temptation is so strong to take a political side for you. I mean, your friend came by and said, hey, take a gun and come to the bridge with us, and you had the temptation to take a political side. And
well,
staying in the middle is very, and I mean, it's hard.
Yeah, probably, but we knew, nobody in the Peace Corps, Shriver, Mankiewicz, nobody said, don't send that letter. I mean, we had already sent it, but then they saw it. So, but the staff sort of knew about it. Somebody could have said, don't send it, or we're going to pull you out. Nobody said that. They backed us up after we sent the letter. And Shriver, at one point, the CIA came to the Peace Corps and wanted to hire volunteers to be translators and help them down there, and Shriver said no. So Shriver was a stand-up guy to people down the street in the State Department, protecting the Peace Corps from meddling by State Department, White House bureaucrats. We all felt that, and but I want to get back. We have time?
Yeah.
I want to get back to your what happened after we did the paving of the streets. In that next year, right? Well, you saw Kay, and then Papa Buelo, his Pedro Antonio Laura. He was president of the club. And to the right was Tati. She was at the time 18, 19 years old. She was head of the women's group of the club. And she started working only because Kay was there, because she told me 50 years later her father wouldn't let her work in the club because there were no women involved and just two male Peace Corps volunteers, and he thought it was inappropriate. I never thought of that either, or I would have requested a female volunteer to help us. But anyway, I found Kay did come out. And they set up a medical dispensary where the doctor came out once a week. They rounded up some bandages, and people came by to get whatever medical treatment they can in one day a week. Amantina, Tati's associate, worked in that. Amantina then went on to medical school, then came back as a doctor to that medical dispensary. There was a school. There was a school built. The Catholic Church was looking around for an area to build a school. And they heard about the Peace Corps and Simón Bolívar, so we're going to see them. They agreed to build a school. Majority of kids there didn't go to school. Why? They couldn't afford the uniforms, couldn't afford the shoes. So they couldn't go to school, so they just ran around all day. I go back 50 years later. This is 2012.
It was an anniversary, a reunion, right?
50th anniversary of the arrival of the Peace Corps. It arrived first in 1962. So Tati, who is now, well, she's 4 or 5 years younger than me, so she's in her 60s now, has a family, kids, grandkids, the whole thing. She says, I tell her I want to go out to the barrio to see what's happening. She takes me out. So we go back to her house. The very house 50 years later where the police hid after we were chased out of the police station, hid in her house. Who lives there? Her older sister still lives in the same bloody house. We sat on the same porch in the front having coffee, probably out of the same cups that we had 50 years ago. And I'm sitting there and say, and the younger sister showed up who worked around the corner. And it was surreal. 50 years later, in the same house, looked the same, felt the same, was the same. And I said, let's go visit the school. Well, the school is now 1,200 kids, still working 50 years later. And I went out in the middle of that school, and I just looked at those kids, and it was really a nice feeling. Go around the corner, and Tati says, there's the medical dispensary. And it's now open 7 days a week. It's two stories high. We got doctors in there, and it's still going on. And I'm thinking, that's pretty cool. It gets better. Walk around the corner, and there's a Venezuelan flag over about five streets. And I ask what that flag is. She says, that's another medical dispensary funded by the Venezuelans. We learned from you all how to do the first one, and therefore we got Venezuelans to do the second one, which comes back to teaching the process of getting things done. Tati broke out of the barrio. Her father was very conservative. Her mother was just a delight. Three sisters, a brother went to Venezuela. But anyway, once you get in there, it's hard to get out. She did. She went to school, had a very active life as a professional in women's movement down there and various other things, and lives, married a great guy, has a factory he runs, great family, great grandkids, and she's out. And it was tough. Her family said, what, we aren't good enough for you here? You got to move out? It's not easy to break out of that, back to that culture of poverty. It's really tough. And BJ, who was the staff member, asked Tati, we're sitting in the car taking this long car trip, asked in the car, Tati, how did you break out? How were you able to do that? And she turned around, pointed at me and said, Peace Corps. And to me, now looking back at my 70 plus years, and I'd done one or two cool things in those 70 plus years.
And a lot of cool things.
nothing compares to what I did when I was 22 years old. And it's a sliver of work. That barrio, but it's just a sliver. But there are 220,000 other Peace Corps volunteers. That's a lot of slivers around the world, a lot of communities. And so it comes back to, I mean, Sarge's idea of, the Peace Corps idea worked. We were in the height of anti-American politics, when everything American was no good, and quite frankly, I have to agree, rightfully so. The Peace Corps was different. Why? Because it did what Sarge originally planned it to do. That's number one. Number two, he took the risk of sending 22-year-old poli-sci majors all around the world, and believing that, I'm overstating a little bit to make a point, believing that good is going to come. They're not going to screw up the way the State Department, AID, and everybody else is telling us they will. Well, we, Peace Corps didn't. And now it's changed. It evolved over the years. It's a different Peace Corps now than it was then. Those of us then sort of thumb our nose at the new kids on the block, which is par for the course. But there's still a lot of good people. To end with one final story. There were more troops in the DR than we had in Vietnam at the time. The big buildup in Vietnam came in September, October, November. So there were 30,000 troops. Believe that's a lot of troops. Well, there's a lot of green. And Bob Hope was a big icon American comedian. Used to go around the world doing shows for the troops. Went to World War II, Vietnam, Korean War. He's been to every war in sight. He would bring Les Brown and the Band of Renown. He would bring Jerry Colonna, a guy with a big black mustache. He would bring some blonde, sexy movie actress. So he came down to the DR with the band, with Jerry Colonna. Joey Heatherton was the sort of the blonde bombshell of the month, and announced that he was going to do some shows. All Americans were invited, except Peace Corps volunteers. So, because we were disloyal. So we went to the soldiers, and the soldiers said, hell with that, come, let's go to the show. And all the soldiers got us into the show.
We're coming up on 1:30, which is full time for this session. There's so much more to get into in Kirby's story. I want to, first of all, say that if anybody wants to stick around and continue the conversation and ask more questions of Kirby and Jamie, that you are more than welcome to do so. We'll still be hanging out for another half hour or so to continue that conversation. I want to also give a quick nod to Jamie to set up how we move forward into next week's session. Okay. Would you mind giving us a quick preview of next week?
Can we close with Sarge?
And then we'll close, yeah.
Okay. Well, next week we'll meet at the same time, and basically what's going to happen is that if this was an introduction into what Sarge built and how it worked, and that this what we'll start next time is what the seeds of that promise were. We'll start with how did it come up that Kennedy made a late campaign promise to create the Peace Corps. What was he doing when he did that? And we'll look at the fact that he really positioned the program as a pragmatic and serious answer to the Cold War dynamics that were going on. And he thought that it was key for America's survival in the world, and how he then handed that off to Sarge, under what conditions. What was Sarge doing when he had that problem? Not what was he doing personally, although a little bit of that, but more like how then when you're given the task, which is, okay, build the Peace Corps and make sure you can build something that will solve the Cold War in key dimensions, what do you do? What did he bring to that task? That's what we'll talk about. That's what we'll talk about next.
We'll have archival tape of Kennedy speeches. We'll also hear directly from Sergeant Shriver as he was in that moment. We'll also have moments where we'll break out and give you decision scenarios that you have to work through to determine what is the best course of action when those kinds of decisions were and forks in the road were facing Sergeant Shriver and others. We'll have some of that next week and then over the next 5 weeks as well. So we want to make sure that there are opportunities for you to get deeply engaged in this and to ask questions as well along the way. We also encourage you to share the word of these seminars with anybody else you think would enjoy and benefit from them. These are open to anybody on campus over the next 5 weeks.
And they, did you talk about the fellowships that it leads to?
Yeah, so let me close with two quick bits of business. Number one, there is a stack of syllabi on the chair sitting immediately next to Kirby that will actually detail what's coming up over the next 5 weeks. We've included a set of historic documents that accompany each session along with a timeline, a chronology of events that correspond. We have emails of those of you who are here today. We will actually post historic documents from today's session that relate. So cables from U.S. Ambassador at the time, transcripts of congressional testimony, accounts of what went on in greater detail that Kirby related for those of you to look at if you want. In future sessions, we will end with a nod to a specific piece of writing that we'd love for you to take a look at before the upcoming session. But that's the syllabus, which I encourage everybody to grab a copy of before we leave. I also mentioned at the outset that Jimmy McDonough and now Maddie Pisani and Tyler as well, all three are alums of the Shriver Fellows Program, which is the second major component of this series. Seminars in the fall, and by the end of November, anybody on campus, and certainly everybody here who's been participating in the seminars, is encouraged to apply to become a Shriver Fellow. Fellows then begin working with us in great detail in January, working through winter and spring quarters. About a dozen of them, building on the methodologies and the insights that these seminars will hopefully share with all of you, to focus on a problem of concern in society, particularly here in Chicago and the communities that surround us, and develop a plan, a project, and a program to tackle that issue. We will provide support, mentorship, training. We've continued to build out the model as we go into this year, so I think it'll be even more robust than last year's was. These students, these fellows, have created the Chicago Peace Corps, which some of you may have heard about. It was featured in the most recent issue of The Maroon. It's dedicated to bringing many of the methodologies that Sergeant Shriver used for the Peace Corps and other places to tackle the problem of youth violence and violence and zero tolerance policies within Chicago public schools. I know we're long on time, so I'll pause. I'll actually give the fellows a chance to talk about that at the beginning of next session, but feel free to grab Jimmy and Maddie or Tyler if you want to chat more about that project. You wanted to close with a clip of Shriver?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do this right here.
Might as well hear the man himself.
Let's see, sorry, I can't, this is sort of odd. All right, here we go.
Nobody thought all this, and this is a fact that for 3 weeks now, I suppose, in the midst of some very bitter fighting, we've had 40 to 50, sometimes more than that, Peace Corps volunteers right in the line of action.
I'm gonna jump this ahead a little bit.
Some of a reaction when they heard a plane go by overhead. These volunteers, numbered 46, 16 of them have decided to extend their security service and go back into the slums of San Domingo. An extraordinary election was held in those slums within the last 2 or 3 weeks. It was an election that the United States, I think, could look upon with a great deal of interest. When the Peace Corps volunteers went to work in the slums, the Community Development Organization of the Dominican Republic selected, I think it was 40 Dominicans to work alongside our volunteers in the slums of Santo Domingo, sort of as a counterpart. After this fighting had been going on for 2 or 3 weeks, The question arose as to whether or not the Peace Corps volunteers should go back into those slums when hostilities stop, and particularly would they be welcome in the very slums where dozens, maybe hundreds, of Dominicans had been killed or injured, where you might be talking to, let's say, this girl, and her sister might have been killed, and you're a Peace Corps volunteer, and they might have been killed by our weapons. Was it safe to send Peace Corps volunteers back into those situations? And would they be welcome? And one of the ways they thought of finding out the answer to that question was to take a secret ballot among these 40 slum dwellers, Dominicans, with whom the Peace Corps volunteers had been working and living. And that ballot was taken. And when the returns were counted, the vote was 40 to nothing in favor of the Peace Corps volunteers coming back into the slums instead of Mendo. That's an election, I repeat, which is perhaps unique for a gringo ever to have won by such a unanimous verdict. It's the kind of election I think our nation has to win, not only in the Dominican Republic, but all over Latin America and all over the world.
Sergeant Shriver, in June of 1965, right?
Right.
So a fitting note to end on, I want to thank all of you for being here. Special thanks to Jamie, and extra special thanks. Please join me in giving a round of applause to Kirby Jones. We're so grateful to you for your time and for sharing your experiences and insights with us.
Thanks for asking.
Very, very moving and enjoyable. Thank you so much. All right. And thank you all for being here.